thought you breathe my existence. You're the one who holds my heart. You made me out of nothing.
Well, good morning and welcome to Trinity. Would you just stand and join us in song? I don't know how you're feeling this morning. Maybe you're feeling kind of worn out, but this song that we're going to sing comes from Isaiah 40, and it reminds us that we serve an everlasting God who gives strength to the powerless and who lifts us up on wings like eagles. So let's sing this morning.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Good to have you here this morning. I am Pastor Tony, one of the pastors on staff here at Trinity. And we want to welcome you this morning. You may be seated. Yes. Be seated. We're going to have you up the rest of the service. So we need you to sit down now, okay? So listen, welcome this morning. We hope that you have a tremendous experience with us this morning, more so with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior today. That's the most important. If you're a guest with us this morning for the first, second, or third time, we'd love for you to take the moment of your time this morning. In the pew in front of you is a connection card. We'd love for you to take that connection card out this morning and just fill out as much information as you do feel comfortable filling out this morning. Later in the service, we will receive his tithes and our offering. As a guest this morning, we just simply ask you to drop that card on the plate. And it's to help us to get in touch with you, to get to know you a little bit better, and hopefully to allow you to get to know who we are here at Trinity a little bit better. And at Trinity, we do have a vision statement here at Trinity, and if you can recite that with me this morning, if you know it, it goes like this. We are here to reaching people, to equip people, to reach people. Very simple, very practical, but very biblical. So we believe that that's what we need to be doing here at Trinity, and everything bounces off of that. And one of the next steps for here at Trinity that we'd ask you to jump into is really our life group. We have about 9 life groups across the Chicagoland area. We'd love for you to get plugged into one of those. If you're just asking yourself, I don't know where one's at, I don't know what one's about, so can you share some information? Just get with me following the service. We can give you some directions in that area. If not, me today, if you'll call the church office, they can probably help you out as well. Not probably, they will help you out as well to be able to get you some assistance in that area. So we welcome you here this morning, and we are thankful that you are here. One touch base here, if I can, today. We are helping to build a home for Habitat for Humanity. And so if you would help us with that, we do have a table out here to the left when you walk out of here this morning, to the left. And I'll tell you what, it's been amazing. You guys have not only filled up the first page of workers, we've had to turn it over. And so that's tremendous. Amen. Thank you. That's tremendous. We thank you for your participation. We thank you for your willingness, but can I just present one need for you right quick in that area? On the other page is where the cooks and those that will help provide the food, I think we have one person. So it's a 1 to 16 ratio. That's not very good. So if we can have some more people sign up on that page on the left, that would be a tremendous opportunity. Again, Mr. Juan can help us out with that. If you're asking for more detailed information about what that looks like, how you can participate in that area, we'd appreciate you being able to do that for us here this morning so we can kind of get that moving forward, because that's coming up here real soon. Within the next couple of weeks, we'll be participating with that area, okay? Again, welcome today. We hope you have a tremendous experience.
Now, would you stand as we continue in song? And I want to read a scripture from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. Isaiah says this: "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, and with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And one called to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, 'Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.' Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar." Listen to this. "And he touched my mouth and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for.' And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here I am, send me.'" Friends, we serve a holy God, and sometimes it's easy to forget that, and it's easy to just kind of get used to thinking that this is a God that we know and we fully comprehend. But this is a God that is so far beyond us. Even the angels say, "Holy, holy, holy, most holy is this God that we serve." So as we sing this morning, let's think about that. Remember that this is a God who deserves our worship, who is worthy of all the praise that we have to give him. Let's sing.
And holy, 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 holy. Holy, holy, holy.
Please, Let's come into the very presence of this wonderful, holy God this morning. I've made a commitment to the Lord Jesus that during our pastor's sabbatical, we would pull together as a congregation and prayer, commitment, doing everything we can to keep the body of Christ, represented by Trinity Church of the Nazarene, strong and vital. I want you to join me in that. One way we can positively do that is every Sunday, as soon as you wake up, begin to pray. Lord, may the Holy Spirit come and really fall on the church today. Wouldn't that be glorious, folks? During the summer, if the Holy Spirit was just unleashed in a marvelous way. You know, this morning I was praying for you teenagers and just asking the Holy Spirit to help you to grow, to become like Jesus. Well, let's pray, shall we? Living Lord, how gracious it is to have an invitation from you to come and seek and knock, to come to you and ask, to come to you and intercede on behalf of other people, to come to you and bring glory and honor and dominion to you. Oh, what a privilege that we have as disciples of Jesus. And we want to start on that level, just say, thank you for the great invitation to communicate, to listen, to talk, and to hear from you. Then, Lord, we thank you this morning for Memorial Day weekend. Our minds go out to the men and women who have served our country and paid the ultimate price. Thank you for what they have done for our freedoms. We're reminded of our men and women who are serving you around the world this morning, on the great seas of the world, serving you, dear Jesus, in countries that are very dangerous. And we pray that you would be very, very close to them. Especially help the chaplains as they minister to them. Oh, Lord Jesus, may there be many men and women who will open their lives to Christ while they're in the military. Then, Lord, we thank you for the other pastors in Naperville who are ministering for you. Jesus, we're reminded this morning of Naperville Presbyterian and Chris Howell. We ask in your name that our brother church, the Presbyterian Church, would be filled with the very presence of God this morning. Our minds race to Danville, where Pastor Edward Piante is having a ministry in the jails among the Hispanic community. Thank you for Pastor Piante's drive and passion to share the gospel with men who have been incarcerated and really are looking for a second chance. Bless his efforts. And then there, Lord, we think of our missionaries today, James and Carla Frazier in Kenya. Thank you, dear Lord, that you can protect them, use them in a special way. I pray that if they're at the university there, they will be anointed as they teach and minister to the various students coming from across that great continent. May you especially be with the Frasers today. We think of our own pastor. Lord, this is the first Sunday that he is not with us as far as preaching and leading us. This will be so strange for Pastor Steve and Kaylee, but would you give them great rest, not only physically, but in their spirits. Affirm them and help them to know how much we love and respect them. Then, Lord, thank you for bringing Jason Lowen to us today. And as he stands behind the sacred desk, we pray that in the name of Jesus, you will anoint him. And we will hear from the living Lord the message you've laid on his heart. May he find it easy to preach to this wonderful congregation. And finally, Lord, we pray that you will receive your tithe and our offerings with gracious, joyful hearts. We're so happy that we can extend your work through giving and supporting your work around the world and here in Naperville. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. And our ushers are coming.
Oh, my soul.
Well, good morning. My name is Randy Lowen. I'm a member of the church board here, and you may have a seat. First of all, I want to say thank you to the worship band. For those of you who come here all the time, you know that we've had many changes in our worship band, and I really appreciate the hard work that these folks do every week to lead us in worship. So would you show your appreciation to them, please? Well, I have a unique privilege this morning of introducing my son as our speaker this morning. I don't know if I've ever done this before, but what I want to tell you is that Jason is on staff for an organization called Dare to Share, based in Arvada, Colorado, which is a suburb of Colorado. And you already were introduced to Dare to Share through our pastor, Steve. If you attended here in April, he did a four-week series? It's a four-week series on life in six words. And Jason's going to build on that this morning as he teaches us on how to share the gospel with our friends. So it's my unique privilege to introduce Jason. Come and share with us what God has given you.
Thanks, Dad. Memorial Day weekend. That's awesome, right? Man, at least for me, it felt like winter flew by. One of the blessings of being in Denver is that when it snows, it melts the next day. So, I mean, if you guys all moved to Denver, I wouldn't blame you, okay? I grew up not too far from here in Naperville. I don't know how much you guys have heard from my parents, but definitely love this area for sure. And I love Memorial Day weekend. How many of you guys have already done a barbecue this weekend? Yeah, and how many of you are planning on more barbecues, right? I mean, you wouldn't be American if you didn't have a barbecue this weekend, although I'm Canadian, but, you know, that's okay. Still do it. We're getting together tomorrow, driving to my brother's house. We're going to go hiking out at Starved Rock and then do a barbecue out at his place, getting all the family together. So I have three young kids sitting right there, Landon, Charlotte, and Aiden, and my lovely wife, Laura. And my mother-in-law, Debbie, yep. and my brother's got three kids too, so excited definitely to get all the grandkids together, and we have aspirations for a perfect day, but it's six kids under seven, so that won't happen. I love barbecue, and I love hiking, and I love fire. Any of you guys in here, like a little bit pyromaniac? A little bit. So it reminds me, about 4 years ago, I was a youth pastor up in northern Michigan. And I had a group of student interns that, I mean, they had just been killing it the whole year, just seeing, you know, their friends trust Christ. Several of these students were instrumental in literally sharing the gospel with every single person in their class at school. And just some awesome group of students. And so we went on this trip where we went up through the UP, crossing over the Hiawatha National Forest, and then down, the goal was to make it over to around Iron Mountain to do a little whitewater rafting trip. And while we were there, we were camping in the national park. I mean, it was a low risk of fire. Apparently that didn't help. We decided to go after breakfast. You know, there's just, the fire had died down after cooking our breakfast, and there's just a couple embers left. And so I had a couple students that were staying by the fire. And then myself and a couple other students went for a walk. Lo and behold, 30 minutes later, walking back, and there is fire and smoke billowing out over the top of the trees. I was like, oh my gosh, no! And I'm like, we're booking it back there. We grab our beach towels, the ones that hadn't burned up already. And I grabbed a 5-gallon bucket of water, an 8-foot pine tree was on fire. Oh, that was all our drinking water. That was not a smart move. So, you know, we're trying to beat the fire down. One of the girls calls 911, the same girl whose dad is a forest fire instructor, you know, teaches people. That didn't turn out well. So the firefighters got the fire in control. They actually commended us for a good fire, and I still to this day don't really understand why they did that. The only thing I can figure is that it was a fire that didn't require a national emergency. You probably didn't hear about this fire on the news, so that's probably why they were saying that. But tell you what, I mean, all of our adrenaline was through the roof, and it was quite the day. And it all started because the conditions were just right, and it was that little single burning ember that blew out of the fire pit and ignited about a half acre of the Hiawatha National Forest. What I found after being in youth ministry for about 10 years, and for the last 2.5 years, working, as my dad said, for this organization called Dare to Share. And I've had the privilege of traveling the country and coaching and training other youth pastors and working with a team of youth pastors that are just killing it. I mean, these guys are getting it done. And through these 28 youth pastors, they're coaching 170 other pastors and youth pastors all over the country, teaching them how to embed the values of a gospel-advancing ministry into their programs and into the way they do ministry. And what I've found and what these trainers have found is that deep down in the heart of every pastor, every youth pastor, and every person in the congregation who's a believer in Jesus Christ, is that deep down that there's this burning ember, this deep passion for Jesus. And oftentimes, it's what started as this raging fire in the souls of believers, it kind of gets lost. You know, over the years and the machinery of ministry, the politics of church policy and programs, this once raging inferno turns into a single burning ember that's buried underneath a pile of church bulletins. You know, in fact, it was just 2 weeks ago, I was talking to a youth pastor in the Denver area where we live, and he was sharing with me that, you know, We were talking about discipleship and evangelism. You know, he had heard where I work and kind of what we do. And he shared with me, he's like, man, like, he said, Jason, you know, one of the things that I've really struggled with is that over the years and just the struggles of the program and this machinery of ministry of trying to make sure that all our programs go off without a hitch, that, you know, that our worship team hits every cue, which you did, by the way. You hit every cue. Good job. And trying to really focus on this, that the focus on discipleship and evangelism gets completely lost. So this morning, I want to introduce you guys to a new word. This is actually a word that we found in an old Charles Spurgeon. Any Charles Spurgeon fans? Yeah, good. If you're not, you should be. This word they found in an old Charles Spurgeon sermon is the word gospelize. Can you say that with me? Gospelize. It's a super cool word, isn't it? It's an old English word similar to this idea of evangelize, but, I mean, way cooler. Spurgeon talks about it this way. He says, I contend for this, that to gospelize a man is the greatest miracle in the world. All other miracles are wrapped up in this one. To gospelize a man, or in other words, to convert him, is a greater work than to open the eyes of the blind. So we need to gospelize our lives. We need to make sure that our ministries are fully gospelized. Our programs, our churches, our schools, our workplaces, and ultimately we want to see that our nation becomes gospelized. I was blessed to have been trained by a youth pastor, actually here in the Naperville area, who understood the importance of a ministry that was fully gospelized. In junior high years, I was homeschooled, and my youth pastor would pick me up in the middle of the day. This happened often, which is a good plug for being a youth pastor and being homeschooled. So was picked up in the middle of the day to go golfing. That was just sweet. So we would go golfing in the middle of the day, and there's no one on the course, but we would share our faith, we would share the gospel with the people at the pro shop, with the cart lady. And then after we were done, we'd go and try and share our faith with the people at Portillo's that were making our hamburgers and our hot dogs. I was trained and raised by a youth pastor that understood the importance of training students to share their faith. And the entire philosophy of this youth ministry was that it was our responsibility as students to share the gospel with our friends. And then he trained us to do that. And then he would share the gospel from the front almost every single week. And through the course of this youth ministry, I mean, we saw hundreds, even thousands of teenagers that were radically impacted by the power and the hope of the gospel. This was a ministry that advanced the gospel with some incredible force all throughout Naperville. But it's easy for us to drift, isn't it? I mean, it's easy for us to, you know, have this raging fire and then to drift and to find ourselves in that place where it's been reduced to just that single burning ember. It's easy for us to get to the point where we've forgotten how to listen to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. You know, when the Holy Spirit says, hey, go share the good news with your neighbor. Hey, go share the good news with your friends. I mean, we have this incredibly precious gift of eternal and abundant life that's been freely offered to all who receive it, to all who believe that Jesus died for our sins and rose on the third day. But it's easy to forget. It's easy for that passion to be reduced to that burning ember. If you can relate to this, if maybe you've been in a season like this in the past, or maybe right now you're feeling like, man, I kind of feel like I might be in that season right now. Don't worry, you're not alone. Actually, the Ephesian church is an incredible example of a church that went from being fully gospelized to institutionalized. And then Jesus tells them exactly what to do to return to our first love. So the first thing is we must first recognize the difference between being gospelized and institutionalized. So I want us to take a look at the way that this early Ephesian church, kind of how they functioned. So let's take a look at Acts chapter 19, verses 8 through 10. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to open Acts chapter 19, verses 8 through 10. It's going to be up on the screen as well. The early church of Ephesus, they were fully gospelized. Check out the word of the Lord. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. That's the way that what they talked about the early believers. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years so that every single one, all of the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. The early church of Ephesus was fully gospelized. So how did they do this? What was characteristic of them? Well, the first thing is that they suffered for proclaiming the gospel, right? But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. I mean, think about that for the moment. When was the last time that you experienced persecution for sharing your faith? I know, right? I mean, this is America. We don't really get persecuted, right? We don't really get murdered or, you know, mauled or anything like that. But I think that, persecution in this country looks differently, and although maybe someday it will look very similar to that, but right now it's maybe being shunned, being made fun of, losing your friends, maybe your social circle rejects you. And I know in the lives of teenagers, right, that's probably one of the most terrifying things you could experience, right? When your circle of friends says, you love Jesus, you're done. If we are sharing our faith, we will be mocked, marginalized, you know, when we're faithful to sharing the good news with our friends and family. I mean, Paul says that, right, in 2 Timothy 3:12. It says, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. I mean, Paul promises it. So it must be true. I mean, it's the word of God. It is true. To be honest, I think that the reason why, you know, there's this incredible movement in the church to go to social justice instead of evangelism is that nobody really gets persecuted for feeding the poor, right? I mean, but as soon as you start opening yourself up to share the gospel with someone, that's when you start opening up to being shamed, to being ridiculed, to being mocked. Now, before you guys send your ushers up here to take me off the stage, like I'm all for social justice, okay? Don't get me wrong. I'm totally for it, but there is no justice without Jesus, right? There's no justice without Jesus. If you're going to give someone bread, give them the bread of life too. If you're going to give someone water, give them the living water too. You guys are about to go build a home here on earth. Make sure you build them a home in heaven too. We must make sure that our outreach programs, that they're fully gospelized. And when we do, we will, like the early Ephesians, be persecuted to some degree or another. So not only were the early Ephesians persecuted for sharing their faith, they were mobilized to multiply. Right, Greg Steer, our founder, Dare to Share, and you know, I sat under him for years as a youth pastor. He says, in order for you to first, before you can multiply, you have to first learn to add. right? My son, Landon, he's in first grade, and my daughter, Charlotte, is in kindergarten. That's what they're doing, right? I mean, in their early elementary years, they're learning to add so that they can multiply. Well, apparently now he's already learning to divide, so that's a different story. Good job, Landon. They were mobilized to multiply. Let's look at Acts 19, 9 and 10. It says, he took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. You know, one of the coolest things about what Paul did is that he did not take it upon himself that he had to personally share the gospel with everyone in the province of Asia. I mean, that would have been impossible. That's modern-day Turkey. And he didn't have a cell phone and a Twitter feed, right? I mean, he would have had to walk everywhere. But what did he do, right? He set up shop in we call affectionately the School of Tyrannus. I mean, this training institute where people will come from all over the province of Asia to get trained. Now, if you kind of check out some of the early church history, the Church of Colossae, which is on the other side of Turkey, was founded first by this guy named Epaphras. If you check out, I believe it's Colossians chapter 1, verse 7. Epaphras, scholars believe, and I'm not one of those scholars, I just read this, but scholars believe that Epaphras never actually even met Paul, was not actually personally trained by Paul. So he was a third generation disciple. So Paul trained someone who trained Epaphras, who launched the church of Ephesus, so that everyone in the entire province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. I mean, that's incredible. These people were mobilized to multiply. And I think it's the passion of the new believer, right? I mean, a lot of times when you first trust Christ, you have this incredible passion, this desire to go and share the gospel with absolutely everyone. And I mean, absolutely, like, no discernment about should I or shouldn't I, you just go. I mean, how many of you guys have met a new believer that's been like that? Right? Most of us, right? It kind of reminds me of this guy named Mike. Mike actually grew up here in Naperville. I met him when I was interning at a church in Warrenville. Mike, he grew up in church, but had never really experienced this transformative power of the gospel. He was just kind of there. He just kind of grew up in church, grew up around, you know, the Christian faith. But so I was interning at the time, and I was running the junior high program. And myself and my buddy Ryan, we trained these junior high students how to share their faith. And honestly, the best way to train someone how to share their faith is to have them share their faith, right? Because you can take classes all day long, but if you never share your faith, it's just head knowledge. And so we're like, man, we really want these junior high students to get it. We want them to live lives that are fully gospelized. And so what do? We went to the Fox Valley Mall. How many of you guys have ever been to the Fox Valley Mall? If you've ever been pestered by a junior high student, that might have been one of my students. So we wanted to take these junior high students, and what was super cool was that these junior high students, they were learning to share their faith, they were sharing their faith, their friends were trusting Christ, and the junior high program was growing, so much so that we couldn't actually monitor all of them at the mall, and so we had to get new leaders. We had enough adults to be able to drive. I mean, that's fairly easy to convince an adult to drive someone to the mall. But to try and convince someone, hey, I want you to be with them as they're sharing their faith, that's a little bit of a tougher sell. So this family in the church, they've been there forever and ever and ever, and super well-respected. I met this guy, Mike. He was a freshman in high school, and I knew that because he was a well-respected young man in the church, that he would do a really good job just hanging out with a couple of the junior high boys and just kind of walking with them through the mall. Well, what happened that day changed his life forever because he experienced the incredible power and the hope of the gospel in a way that he'd never experienced before. He saw these junior high students who, you know, 2-3 years younger than him, his sister being in junior high at the time, and they were living out their faith in a way that he'd never seen before. And it changed him. It rocked him. So Mike, he ended up in the next 3.5 years through the remainder of his time at Naperville North High School, shared the gospel with more students than I've ever seen another kid share the gospel with. He probably shared the gospel with nearly every single student in his class. This is Naperville North. I mean, this is a big high school, right? He saw dozens and dozens of people on his track team and people in his class trust Christ and get plugged into the local church. He was on fire. I mean, his thought was, I mean, if a junior high kid can do it, so could he. And it immediately changed his outlook on his experience in high school. So does this describe you? I mean, would you say that you have this incredible excitement about the gospel, that you can't just sit there, you have to get up and share the good news with others? With your friends, your family, your strangers, coworkers? Are you so in love with Jesus that you can't help but talk about him? Are you, like the early church of Ephesus, fully gospelized? You know, and sadly, 40 years or so after Acts 19 was written, we get a different view of the Ephesian believers. While the early church of Ephesus was fully gospelized, the later church of Ephesus had become fully institutionalized. Let's take a look at Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. It's going to be up on the screen. You're welcome to turn in your scriptures. The Ephesian church had gone from being fully gospelized to fully institutionalized within just 40 years. Jesus writes this. He says, "To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardship for my namesake and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first." I mean, Jesus commends this Ephesian church, right? I mean, the first couple of things he says is great. And I think that there's a lot of churches that Jesus would say that to today. And I believe Trinity is one of those churches, right? I mean, they work hard at their programs, and that's something we should do, right? We should do our programs with excellence. And Jesus commends this Ephesian church for that. They worked hard at their programs. Jesus says, "I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance." You know, I've worked with and interacted with churches all over the country, right? And they run their VBS, they got their Sunday school, they got their Sunday morning program, they got their Sunday night program, they got their Wednesday night program, right? When someone's confused, they counsel them, right? When someone gets engaged, they marry them. When someone dies, they bury them. They work hard, and like the Ephesian believers, churches today tend to be very hardworking, and that is commendable. It is. The Ephesians not only worked hard, right? They stood for and taught sound theology. I mean, Jesus says about the later Ephesian believers, he says, "I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. And I know that my parents would not be here at Trinity if that was not also true of you. If as a church you did not stand for sound theology, most of you would probably leave." Right? This is a church that stands on sound theology, and that is commendable. The Ephesian believers, they worked hard at their programs, they stood for and taught sound theology. But Jesus has this to say about them, that they lost their first love. He says, "Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first." So then that begs the question, right? What was their first love? I can tell you what it wasn't. It wasn't evangelism. And it wasn't disciple-making. Their first love was Jesus. Because if you fall in love with evangelism, I mean, that's going to fizzle out, right? If you fall in love with disciple-making, that's going to flame out. But I can guarantee you, if you fall in love with Jesus, then you will always be about evangelism, and you will always be about disciple multiplication. So I wonder how many of us in this room have forsaken our first love. You know, we've gotten so wrapped up in running programs, leading church activities, but our hearts have grown cold and our mission has gone missing. Reminds me of actually one of our certified trainers, a good friend of mine who several years ago, his name's Jeff, he was a youth pastor at a Mennonite church in Ohio. This guy worked hard. I mean, he came out of YWAM as a missionary in Egypt, him and his wife, and didn't really know what God was calling him to, realized God was calling him into ministry, and they were working hard, protecting sound doctrine, but over time, you know, over several years in ministry, had kind of gotten to that point where they had moved from being fully gospelized to institutionalized. And I met Jeff at this event called Lead the Cause. We got a couple students, and I know Pastor Katie's bringing a group this summer to Lead the Cause, which, just as a quick plug, it's a Dare to Share event. It's a summer training event, a week-long summer training event that, as a youth pastor, I took students to and never saw more transformation come out of 1 week than I did out of Lead the Cause. We saw more than 50% new conversion growth every single year, in large part due to the training that students got and I got at this event, Lead the Cause. So it was my second year at Lead the Cause, and I met this guy, Jeff, and through the course of this week, I mean, God just wrecked him, because he realized that he had forsaken his first love, just like the Ephesian church had moved from being fully gospelized to institutionalized. And it just kind of made him sick that this is where he'd come. And that week, both himself and his students realized, man, something has to change. And so he began implementing some of the same values that the Apostle Paul used to launch the early church, like intercessory prayer and relational evangelism and leaders that model it, a disciple multiplication strategy, a bold vision, focusing on the biblical outcomes. And he started focusing on this stuff, and God started doing some amazing things. He very quickly began seeing that 20, 30, 40% new conversion growth in his ministry. But the problem was the senior leadership at his church fired him. Fired him. Because they would much rather have an institutionalized church, because it's not very messy, and it's easy, it's comfortable. But one of the things I love about Jeff's story is it didn't end there. God was so using him in his community and with the other youth pastors that he was interacting with. He was a worship pastor and a youth pastor, that he actually became what he affectionately titled himself as a musicianary. So now he travels around the country, and he trains worship leaders and he trains youth pastors on how to implement these values in their ministry. And here's what's crazy. Just kind of from understanding what it looks like to raise funds to be a fully supported missionary stateside, it typically takes over 2 years to raise funds to do that. It took him less than 3 months because God's hand was so heavily on him. So how did Jeff do this? How did he turn this around? Well, he returned to his first love. He returned to his love for Jesus, and this resulted in him returning to the mission of Jesus, which is to seek and save the lost. Jeff got gospelized. Fortunately, Jesus tells us three steps on how to return to getting gospelized again. Let's look at Revelation 2, verse 5. He says, "Consider how far you have fallen, repent, and do the things you did at first." Realize, repent, and return. These are the three things that that Jesus specifically told this Ephesian church, and I believe he's telling us too, that we need to do in order to get gospelized again. To realize, repent, and return. This realize how far you've fallen. This is where we need to begin asking ourselves some pretty tough questions. Questions like this. Are we more about programs than about reaching lost people? Have we engaged our own neighbors in gospel conversations? Do we only run outreach programs where the lost have to come to us to hear the good news, or are we more like the Ephesian church, where we go to where the lost are? Do we bag out on personal evangelism because, you know, we got pictures of missionaries in our foyer and they do that? Or we hired the professionals to do that? You know, do we look at the last and lasting mandate of Jesus, the Great Commission, as the Great Commission, or is just a good suggestion? Let's remember how far we've fallen. Let's remember the love we had at first, the passion we had at first. At first, we must remember. We must repent. Repent for losing our first love. Now, what I love about the word repent is that the meaning is super simple. It just means to change your mind, to transform your thinking. Repent, to change your mind or transform your thinking. We need to repent of that that lack of fire, that lack of vision. And then we need to return to doing what is burning in your heart deep down. As a follower of Jesus, I do believe that there is that single burning ember in your heart. And for some of you, God's already been fanning that into flame and bringing about that place where you are becoming more fully gospelized. We need to repent and do the things we did at first. And what was it that the Ephesians did at first? They gospelized, right? I mean, they took the gospel all over the province of Asia. They made and multiplied disciples until everyone everywhere heard the gospel. And why did they do this? Because they were so in love with Jesus that they couldn't just sit there under the Apostle Paul's teaching. I mean, are we like that? I mean, we can't just sit here under Pastor Steve's teaching and the other pastors here. Do we have to go and share the gospel? So may we, just like the Ephesian church of Revelation, remember, repent, and return to our first love, to move from being institutionalized back to being gospelized. Did you guys know that there's 300,000 Protestant evangelical churches in this country? 300,000. That's a lot of churches, right? Do you know that there's only 12,000 Starbucks? How is it that 12,000 Starbucks can saturate this entire country in caffeine and 300,000 Protestant evangelical churches can't get this done? Right? I'm convinced that if we can just get 10%, just 30,000 churches all in for being fully gospelized, that we can reclaim this country. We can gospelize this country. But it's going to begin with men and women like myself and like you guys who are willing to first gospelize our lives so that we can see a church that is fully gospelized, so that we can transform churches in this country. Because the local church is God's plan A, and there is no plan B. Makes me think of another Spurgeon quote. He says, "Brethren, do something, do something, do something. While societies and unions make constitutions, let us win souls. I pray you be men of action, all of you." To move from being institutionalized to gospelized. Who is ready to do something? Will you bow your heads for a minute? Close your eyes. So I want to challenge you. If you are willing to make this transition from being institutionalized to gospelized, or maybe in your heart you know, like, man, like I've already begun making that transition down this road to being fully gospelized, but you want more, then in just a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to stand. And by taking a stand, you're remembering, repenting, and returning to the first love in your hearts. By taking a stand, you're saying you're willing to do whatever it takes in your own life to love Jesus and tell others about him. So if you're willing to say, "Yes, Lord, fully gospelize me and my church," then take a stand right now. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I want to encourage you guys who are standing to find two or three people around you right now, and I want you to pray together out loud, and I want you to call out to the Lord, to repent, call out to him, and ask God to bring revival in this place. Don't be ashamed. Pray, and let's shake this place with the power of prayer. So I'm going to start us off. I want you guys to get into groups of two or three, and let's shake this place with the power of prayer. Jesus, God, I pray that right now that you would bring your Holy Spirit in a powerful way upon the men and women and the children and the teenagers here at Trinity to bring revival, that we might be fully gospelized. And praise God for what he's doing here this morning. Let's give God a hand for the way he's moving right now. You guys can grab your seats. Hey, I want to bring up Jillian, and she's going to be sharing the gospel with a friend named Amanda. Not actually Amanda. So they went to the Dare to Share conference a couple weeks back, and they're going to kind of show you some of the things that they learned, and then we're going to kind of walk through that.
Hello. Work, work, Angelica, work, work.
Wait, is that Hamilton?
Yes, it's Hamilton.
Oh my goodness, I love Hamilton.
Me too.
I really, really want to go see Hamilton in Chicago, but tickets are just so expensive.
I know, but like, luckily I got to see them like a couple weeks ago.
No way. Oh my goodness, I'm so jealous right now. Oh, I want to go see Hamilton. I, like, just because I love how they, like, found a way to, like, make history into rap, and I love rap.
I know, me too.
What other rap, like, artists do you like?
Well, I kind of like Drake and, you know, stuff like that. What about you?
Well, not many people have heard of them, but I really like, Lecrae and KB. Like, they're really cool.
Yeah, never heard of them.
Oh my goodness, okay, you have to listen to them. I've been to, like, 3 Lecrae's. Concerts, and I've been to one of KB's, and yeah, here, wait.
Sound good.
See this album right here? This is my favorite one.
Oh, Church Clothes? Yeah, that's why I haven't heard of them. They're those Christian wannabe rappers. Yeah, please tell me you're not one of them.
One of who?
A Christian? I'm an atheist. Yeah, I thought this was gonna work out, you know? You like Hamilton, so do I.
No. Yeah, I'm a Christian. What makes you believe that there's not a God?
I mean, the whole thing just kind of seems like a huge fairy tale to me.
Yeah, I understand that. One of the things that I really like, that I really think is cool about atheists is just like their scientific, their devotion to scientific reason.
I mean, if there really was a God, like I have so many unanswered questions. Like,
yeah, there's some questions that I wish God would answer for me too. But there's also some things that science can't answer that Christianity can.
Then why are you a Christian?
Well, because before I was a Christian, I never really fit in anywhere. And I was constantly trying to figure out, you know, who I was. And I really felt lost. And, I mean, growing up in a church my whole life, you would think that I would know why I felt that way. Because a lot of the times they tell you that the reason why you feel that way is because you need God to fulfill you. And, yeah, so, but a couple of years back ago, I hit rock bottom, and I just really went and seeked God and like gave my life fully to him. And ever since then, it's just, I don't know, I just can feel so like reassured that God has my back. Does that all make sense?
Kinda. I mean, I guess, but it's just a lot to take in. I mean, I would have to think about it. Like, that's a lot to wrap my head around. I mean, yeah, I get how you feel. Like, I feel lost in, like, my own world. Like, I don't understand. But, I mean, it's just kind of, I'm kind of scared to, like, put my faith into, like, an unseen God.
Yeah, I understand that. But did you know that God created us to be with him, but our sinful desires separate us from him? And did you know that?
Well, I mean, I'm not a bad person. Because, like, I mean, yes, I make mistakes, but I make them up by, like, going out and, like, in my community and, like, helping, like, volunteering.
What kind of volunteer work do you do?
Like, Feed My Starving Children and stuff.
Yeah, I really like Feed My Starving Children, but actually, desires can't be erased by doing good deeds, which is fortunate. Also, we would constantly be doing good deeds, and even some of the things that we did wouldn't make up for all of the sins that we've committed.
So...
But luckily, we have God, Jesus' one and only Son, died for us to pay the price for our sins.
Wait, someone's died for my sins?
Yeah.
Why?
Because he loves you and he wants to be with you. But luckily, the good news is he's not still dead. He's alive and he rose again. And our life with Jesus could start now and last forever.
Interesting.
Is there anything that's keeping you from putting your faith in Jesus right now?
I mean, I'm just kind of scared. I would have to, like, think about this. Like, this is a lot to take in.
And I totally understand that. Do you mind if I pray for you? Yeah, I like that.
Awesome. Give these girls a hand. Didn't they do a great job? Thank you. You guys are awesome. Just grab the mic and hang out right there. Just hang right there. Awesome. So, Tim, could you throw the slide up, the GUSPEL? Hopefully you guys remember this, right? God created us to be with him. Our sins separate us from God. Sins cannot be removed by good deeds. Paying the price for sin, Jesus died and rose again. Everyone who trusts in him alone has eternal life. And life with Jesus starts now and lasts forever. This is the whole message of the gospel. This is the meta-narrative that runs from Genesis to Revelation. And these girls nailed it. Nailed it. Good job. Yeah. They went to the Dare to Share conference just a couple weeks ago, right? So just in like 2 days, learned that and learned how to have a gospel conversation. So I asked them to pretend one of them was one of their unsaved friends. So that was kind of where that scene came from. So what we're going to do right now, hope we're going to leave this up there for a little bit. I want to help you guys learn to have gospel conversations. So these girls have gospel call and gospel response. So in just a minute, they're going to do just a super quick example of what that looks like. And then they're going to pass these cards out, and I'm going to call a letter, and you guys are going to participate. This is going to be a fun, interactive. We're going to get this together, all right? So if I call out G, whoever has gospel, G call right there. So it says G call. So what would you say? Go for it. Just say it nice and loud. Yeah, so she listed off, right, God created us to be with him, right? And then what would you say, Jillian?
God wants to have a personal relationship with us, and he actually cares about us.
Yeah, so she responded to what that sentence is, because the goal is not gospel presentations, the goal is gospel conversations. So when I say a letter, I'm going to say O, so you guys can go pass them out, 12 random people, your favorite people in the whole congregation. So if I say a letter, say I say O, whoever has O call is going to stand up and going to recite, our sins separate us from God. And then whoever has O response is going to stand up and respond to that. You could respond with a Bible verse, right? Maybe it's Romans 3:23. There, I just gave you a hint for O. Right? So you could respond with a Bible verse, or you could respond with a thought or an idea. All right? All right, you guys got them all passed out? Almost all there. Don't pass them down the row. I see that. No, you can just hold on. You just hold on your card. All right, who's got G? All right, stand up. Who's got G? Call. Go ahead. Yeah, G call. Nice and loud.
God created us to be with him.
Awesome. Who's got G response? Yeah, he created us. He wanted to be with us. And yeah, absolutely, awesome, for sure. All right, S. Who's got S? Sin's gotta be. Who's got response? I know it's out there. Who's got S response? Who's hiding it? Someone point him out. Who's hiding it? Okay, what's S response? How would you respond to that? So the idea that sins cannot be removed by good deeds, how does that make you feel?
Okay. It makes me feel like I need to work at it.
Yeah, you recognize that there's a distance between you and God, right? And there's something has to be done, right? Awesome. All right, how about, you can, after you respond, you can pass it to someone around you. Okay, so don't hold on to that card, pass it to someone else. All right, how about O? Who's got O?
Our sins separate us from God.
Awesome, good job. Who's got O response?
Our sins may separate us, but Jesus is always trying to close that gap.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Jesus wants to close that gap that we created by our sins, for sure. How about L? Who's got L? Yeah. And just to let you know, at the conference, when we do L, we say life with Jesus starts now and lasts forever! Okay, who's got L response?
Yeah, so that ember, right, that ember needs to be a fire.
Yeah, absolutely. Good. All right, how about G? Who has the new G? Pass it to someone? Okay. Yeah, G call. God created us to be with Him, for sure. Who's got a new G call?
He's trying to get rid of her, right?
All right, how would you respond to G call? Yeah, yeah, you had it. You can't remember. That's cheating. Yeah, yeah, well, what does that make you feel? Like a verse that might correspond with that? Absolutely, absolutely, right, for sure. So the purpose of this exercise is to get us familiar with, get us comfortable with having gospel conversations. Because what you don't want to do is walk up to someone, hey, my name is Jason, God created us to be with Him, our sins separate us from God, sins cannot be removed by good deeds, paying Christ for sin, Jesus died and rose again, everyone who trusts in Him alone has eternal life, and life with Jesus starts now and lasts forever. You want to be a Christian?
Yes!
So that's what you don't want to do, don't do that, right? And what I thought was awesome about what these two girls did as they were doing a role play is it took them a little bit before they got to the G, right? So we teach a strategy at Dare to Share. It's super, super simple. I can give you an entire crash course in like 4 seconds. Ask great questions, admire what you can about what they believe, and admit the reason you're a Christian is that you're so messed up, you need Jesus to save you. Ask, admire, admit, okay? And then you walk into the G-O-S-P-E-L. So don't worry, we're not going to do any more of the thing. But what I would encourage you to do, first of all, is to give those cards to Pastor Katie so that she can work with the teens with them. And here's why. Here's why I gave my life to youth ministry. Teens are the easiest, the quickest to get them to change what they believe. And they can mobilize the gospel faster than anybody else. Sorry, adults, it's true. Right? And I'm an adult now, so making fun of myself. So here's what I want us to do. I want to bow your heads one more time. We're gonna do one more thing. I'm gonna give you guys an opportunity before we do that. Maybe there's some people in here in this room that as I was sharing about the good news of Jesus Christ. That Jesus died on the cross for your sins. Right? That paying the price for sin, Jesus died and rose again. And maybe that's the first time you heard that. Or maybe it was the first time it made sense. Maybe like my friend Mike, you've grown up in the church and you've heard messages like this before, but it's never really made sense. You've never experienced the power of the gospel. That everyone who trusts in Jesus alone will have eternal, abundant life. And that life, it could start now, right now, in this very moment, and will last forever. And the only thing that is asked of you is that you believe that Jesus is who He says He is, and that you trust Him for life. For eternal life. So I just, with every head bowed, with every eyes closed, if this morning, that makes sense to you, maybe for the very first time, in just a moment I'm going to have you just slip your hand up just so I can pray for you. And slipping your hand up, raising your hand, that doesn't save you. Even praying a prayer doesn't save you. Believing upon the Lord Jesus Christ is what saves you. So if this morning you've never come to that place where you said, I want to have this eternal life, then would you just slip your hand up just right where you're at, every head bowed, every eye closed. Jesus, before we go from this place, I pray that you would give us an opportunity that you would bring to our hearts even right now, people that we might share the good news of the gospel with. Thank you for that good news. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right. When you guys walked in this morning, there was two wonderful ladies at the tables back there who handed out pen and paper and an envelope. Some of you guys may have doodled on that. Just raise your hand, and Larry back there, my friend back there, I just met this morning, he's going to bring you a new one. So if you doodled on it, just raise your hand, and he'll get you a new one. Here's what I want you guys to do. Oh, we got one doodler down here. It's okay. It's great to doodle. So here's what I want you guys to do. Over the next couple minutes, Pastor Caleb's going to come up. He's going to be playing just some quiet songs in the background. We're going to give you guys about 3, 4, or 5 minutes. I want you guys to put someone's name on the top of that piece of paper right now. Who is someone that you know that doesn't know Jesus? And then if we could, yeah, the gospel's up there. I want you guys to begin crafting a letter to that person. How many times do you guys get a handwritten letter from someone? Not very often, right? So I want you guys to think about someone that doesn't know Jesus, someone that you know, that you care about, and I want you guys this morning to write that letter. You may not finish it, and that's okay. And I want you to write that letter to your unsaved friend. So go ahead and, where Pastor Caleb went. But if you guys want to begin just crafting that letter, I encourage you to incorporate the G-O-S-P-E-L. Oh, there you are, Pastor Caleb. Incorporate the G-O-S-P-E-L so you can know and have confidence that you're sharing a clear gospel message. As Pastor Steve is beginning his sabbatical, how awesome would it be if as a result of these letters and these gospel conversations that you're beginning right now, if when he got back, was it 9 weeks? If when he got back, the sanctuary was full because of the gospel conversations that you start today. So would you guys do me a favor? Would you turn to the person next to you and just say to them, on Monday this letter is being mailed out. Would you make that commitment to the person sitting next to you? Just turn to them, say, on Monday, I'm mailing this letter out. Jesus, I thank you for the men and women here and the children and the teenagers here at Trinity. And Jesus, I just ask that you would use these letters that have been started, God, that you would use them to spark revival in the circles of our friends and our family and our neighbors. That God, as a result of the G-O-S-P-E-L, God, that you would transform this community, that you would transform this church, that every single person in here would have the privilege of being able to lead someone to Jesus in these next 9 weeks, so that as Pastor Steve returns at the end of his sabbatical, that he would return to a new church, God, a church that has been fully gospelized. So God, I thank you for the men and women and their commitment to be fully gospelized, so that this church may be fully gospelized. I pray your blessing over these letters. I pray that as they get finished later today, and maybe first thing tomorrow, Jesus, would you just bring about your inspiration? Would your Holy Spirit move in the hearts and move through these pens and these pencils? God, that these letters might be received and read, and that, God, that you would bring about some conversations that would change the lives of hundreds of people. Thank you, Jesus, for this time this morning. Amen.
Thank you, Jason. Really, what's been shared this morning is what the Holy Spirit's already been talking to us about. It just came out in words today from a man who's believing in what God is calling him to do, and that's to share the gospel and to teach us how to do that in a very practical way. There was always a fear in sharing the gospel, a fear of rejection, right? And it's not just in relation to the teenagers over here, to the students, but to us in the work environment, to us in our neighborhoods, and to us in our family gatherings. There's always that little fear, right, of being ostracized and being looked at as, oh, yeah, you're that person. But the truth is that we need to be that person. And I trust today that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you as he has been speaking to me, to send my letter out to my dad and to remind him that there's a God who loves him. There's a God who loves me and who I surrender to one day. But I need to communicate that to him. And I trust you have family that you need to communicate to that as well. So may God anoint the letters that goes out this week, goes out tomorrow. Listen, the mail's not running tomorrow, but get it in there anyway, because we won't get it out. We will delay, and it will not happen. So let us do that tomorrow. If you'll stand with us this morning, we'll say our benediction as we are accustomed to doing here at Trinity. May the Lord bless you today. I truly believe that today, and may you really experience his blessing in your life. So let us say it together. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face unto you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face to you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. You are sent. Amen. Bless you today.